The objective of this screencast is to show the relationship between the Arrhenius relationship and the thermodynamic interpretation of transition state theory expression, otherwise known as the Eyring equation. So I put up an example that we've considered in another screencast, which is a very simple reaction. So the isomerization of CNH to HCN that involves a triangular transition state where the hydrogen is basically hopping across the rest of the molecule. And the transition state occurs about where the hydrogen is halfway across. That's the highest point in energy. We have shown previously that we could determine the rate of this kind of reaction. So we wrote that the rate constant from transition state theory for this kind of reaction, which would be a first order rate constant, is equal to this collection of constants like Boltzmann's constant and Planck's constant, right, with the temperature, and then an equilibrium constant for the transition state that can be calculated based on the Gibbs free energy difference between the transition state for the reaction and the reactant, where that equilibrium constant we assume can be calculated as the exponential of that negative Gibbs free energy change over RT, just as if we were dealing with a reaction between a stable reactant and a product. We want to understand something about how this rate constant that's really defined based on sort of first principles and assumptions about the nature of the potential energy surface to a purely empirically derived relationship for the rate constant, which is the Arrhenius expression, which tells us that the rate constant is equal to some temperature independent prefactor times an exponential of the negative activation energy, which is also temperature independent, over RT. To do this comparison, we'll actually start by looking at a little bit different definition of the activation energy. And first, we simply take the log of both sides of this equation, and then we're going to take the derivative of both sides of the equation with respect to the temperature. When we take that derivative, the first term is a constant with temperature, so it becomes zero. The second term, when we take the derivative, we get an E over RT squared, and the sign changes. So this is another way of really defining the activation energy that is equal to RT squared times this derivative quantity. Right, we're going to basically take the same kind of derivative with respect to this rate constant. So first we take the log of both sides, and now we're going to take the derivative with respect to temperature. Now in this first term, when we take the derivative of a natural log, we get 1 over the argument, so h over kBT. And we multiply that by the derivative of the argument with respect to temperature, which is kB over h. And so these terms cancel with the h and kB, and we're left with just a 1 over temperature from that first term in the sum. And for the second term, we can rely on a derivation from classical thermo that's known as the Van 't Hoff relationship, which relates the behavior of the equilibrium constant to temperature. And as you might remember, for an endothermic reaction like the one we're dealing with here, the sign of delta H with our sign convention is that it will be positive. If we're going from reactants to transition states, we're going up in enthalpy. And we expect that as the temperature increases for an endothermic process, that the equilibrium constant will also increase. And hence, we have this positive dependence on the enthalpy. The opposite, although it doesn't apply for most cases where you are dealing with a transition state, the opposite would be true for an exothermic reaction. And again, the Van 't Hoff relation is what relates the equilibrium constant to temperature, and it does so through the enthalpy of that reaction. In this case, that reaction is from the reactant to the transition state, where now we can also plot enthalpy on this diagram and track what delta H to the transition state is. That will define how the equilibrium constant, and actually therefore the rate constant, will change with temperature. So if we clean this up and re-express these two terms in the sum, we just get a 1 over T plus an enthalpy to the transition state, enthalpy change to the transition state, divided by RT squared. To make it convenient to combine these terms, we can just go for a common denominator. And so to get that, we can multiply both the numerator and denominator of the first term by RT. And that will give us RT over RT squared. And therefore, we can see by comparing the equation on the left and on the right, on the left-hand side, both are d log k dt. And so we're going to expect the two right-hand sides to also be equal. And we see that, therefore, we expect that the Arrhenius activation energy is related to the enthalpy to the transition state plus RT. All right, and so it turns out that the activation energy is generally very close in value to the enthalpy difference between the reactants and the transition state. And that's because RT, at most, for most reactions of interest, say that are conducted at room temperature to 500 Kelvin or so, right, RT will have a value of approximately 1 kcal per mole. Right, whereas typical enthalpy change to a transition state for a reaction we might care about can have various values, but you're usually looking at something kind of in the range of 10 to 35 kcals per mole. Therefore, RT is a relatively small fraction of the activation energy, and majority of it in most cases is determined by the enthalpy change to the transition state. And that way, on one of these plots, we can compute the enthalpy change to the transition state, and that essentially tells us right away the activation energy. And if we want to try to be more accurate about it, we can add this small factor of RT. One thing that I want to clarify with this diagram is that the Gibbs free energy and the enthalpy are related to each other through the addition of the temperature times the entropy change. They'll both look qualitatively like this, but they won't follow exactly the same trend. And I just took a shortcut using the same diagram for both G and H. They will not follow exactly the same shape or have the same values since they are offset from each other by T delta S. Finally, the other thing that I want to note about this relationship is that it is actually dependent on the molecularity of the reaction. And so what I mean by that is that this is a first order reaction with a first order rate constant, so that we only have a unimolecular reaction. In other words, one molecule goes to make one molecule in the product state. The other common case that we typically are interested in would be a bimolecular reaction. So where A and B must collide with each other to form a transition state that then leads to products. In that case, we actually get a different relationship if you go through and do this same kind of derivation. And that relationship is just that we get an extra factor of 2 in front of the RT for a bimolecular reaction. And trimolecular reactions are rare. But if you do have a trimolecular case, then that 2 just becomes a 3. In other words, the factor that's in front of RT is directly related to the molecularity of the reaction.